impression the prince should have about you as a person for him to listen to you. And you are at the same time very smart. He cannot be looking at you as arrogant, which is your quality. So that type of impression should get created in an interaction with the client by which he can trust you, by which you can give a blunt recommendation which is good for the client, and you should feel comfortable listening to him. And even now, whenever they have an issue, they give me a call. Now whenever they want to hire a CEO or a head of a unit, before making the final decision, they'll ask me, Thomas, can you at least meet him for 10-15 minutes? Just talk to him over the phone. Are you comfortable? That is the type of relationship you have with your client. The client starts trusting you much more beyond the assignment that you did. He's trusting you with his children. Like I have done an assignment in which the father comes and asks me that I have these three children, can you talk to them and tell me who should be where? Which son should handle? And sometimes the eldest person may be the most, I don't want to say stupid, not the most intelligent person. That means you have to allow the younger son to manage some of the prominent areas of the business. We have instances in which the father and the son are completely different views of the business. I have seen that in many, many businesses. The father wants to continue the core business and the son wants to become an investment banker, like every young kid. It's completely in contradiction. And we have to facilitate a discussion between a father and a son saying that, hello, you have to decide between yourself. Your son wants to run a portfolio company, sell, buy. Your father wants to continue making pasta. That's his business. He's making so much of money. And we have to facilitate a discussion between them and say that, okay, let the father continue running the pasta business for some years and you just manage it for you, and over a period of time when the father is tired of running the business, then you make it like a portfolio company. So these are the type of discussions and activities that happen in a consulting assignment. So it is not about having intelligence, extensive analytical skills, coming up with recommendations and conclusions. These are all required, but this is nowhere sufficient for you to do a good consulting assignment. It is with all your intelligence, all your capabilities, all your experience to be presented as the most humblest person, at the same time able to talk to the client and give them blunt feedback without them feeling threatened or ashamed or awkward in exposing things to you and sharing the family matters and sharing all the fundamental issues they have in the company, and even believing that you can, with your limited experience compared to that person, and you as an individual or as a firm, can resolve these very intricate issues. That was a long answer for a short question, I guess. So I leave it to you for you to decide what is a good consultant. And these are the type of things we will try to evaluate in a consulting interview. How do we evaluate it? This is by case studies. We'll give you some situations. We'll ask you what you have done. And we want to see how you communicate those messages. Structured communication is one. I'm not even going into the basics. Like you have to be smart, intelligent, analytical, and hardworking. That's all given. Right? Things which are not very obvious are the things which I'm sharing now. Everybody knows that structured communication is very important, but you are not realizing the importance of it. Yeah, let me give you a perspective again on that. Let us say you are doing a project for Singapore Airlines. A Singapore Airlines strategy assignment, let us say you put 3 to 4 people for 12 weeks, it will cost around $1 million. Okay. In a $1 million assignment, how many times do you think you will meet the board members who will take it? That's all you do. That means, and each interaction with the board, let us say it is 3 times in an assignment, it's costing, or let us say 4 times. I can divide easily. $250,000 per interaction. See, in a consulting assignment, your output is what the client heard from you. You can do tons of analysis and regression analysis and charts and all. If the client doesn't read it, understand it, comprehend it, understand the implication, and doesn't use that for changing strategy, that is completely useless. You may be intellectually so happy, intellectually very happy that you did an amazing analysis, but it was completely useless if the client did not get that message. Right? So the perspective I'm trying to give is, each interaction, which is like half an hour with the board, is costing them $250,000 to $300,000. Cost to on the assignment of, now imagine the cost of their time, how much opportunity cost they are on taking another decisions. They may be taking a decision to make $1 billion investment. You see? So, and they cannot sit with you for more than half an hour. They will get bored. They cannot sit with you for more than half an hour, or maximum an hour. The maximum you can keep a board engaged with you is 1 hour, but that is very rare. Normally you get half an hour, 45 minutes, and that's it. Now you have to convey the complete analysis of 3 to 4 weeks or 4 to 5 people. All the crisp messages has to be conveyed to them in that limited time, and they have to understand your analysis, your recommendations, they have to accept it, they have to buy it, and they have to agree to implement it. That is the perspective you should have, and that is how important structured communication is in consulting. It is not just structuring you have to understand what happens. How important is this? You're giving an output worth this much in such, every second you're talking to, let us say, an owner of a company, he's costing you thousands or ten thousands of dollars every second you're talking. So that is why, you know, these are the type of qualities which are extremely important. Teamwork, again I told you about that, yeah? An individual output can never ever be correct, I can guarantee you that. No way. If anybody believes that I can come up with an output which is good quality and you did it alone, it is absolute rubbish. It has to get debated, has to get validated by colleagues at multiple levels, and you should be open to make criticism. And the best criticism is when a junior person gives a senior person. The reason is because the junior person has less experience and hence less things constraining his mind. So you have to encourage that environment in the office by which an analyst tells the partner that you're stupid. And we try to do that in our strategic. I think that is another differentiation in India. I don't think any other consulting firm allows the flexibility or encourages the flexibility of an analyst or a consultant questioning a fundamental presentation or recommendation made by experts and senior people in the company, and that happens very much in ADA. And it is not done as a favor. If you don't do it, you are stupid actually, because the person with limited knowledge is already thinking very wide and he's already able to ask you questions, and if you're not able to answer it, you're going to be miserable in front of the client. And you should, the issue is not whether he can ask, the issue is creating that environment in the office. That is the tougher part. For some reason, before people come to ADL, I always have this impression, they talk about partners like people who are invisible, cannot see them, and all this rubbish stuff. That doesn't help in consulting at all. So these are the type of, you know, people you are looking for. These are not, I don't want to say ADL. Generally, these are people who will be suitable for a consulting job. This type of profile, they will handle the situation and able to work and produce good outputs, work with the team, not to show off, not arrogant, at the same time maintaining the quality and dignity and the internal feeling has to be there that I'm really good. Because if you don't have a feeling that you're not good, then it will start affecting your output. You're very careful in making recommendations. Because I have seen people who are sometimes trying to be a bit careful because you're not very sure. That will affect your output. You see, you have to make a stance, you have to make a view. Let somebody else question. But somebody else with more experience questioning. But you cannot inhibit your thoughts. You cannot inhibit your recommendations. You have to bring it up. Challenges in Middle East. I know people have a very wrong about the Middle East. I don't think the challenges in the Middle East are very different compared to many other places. You may have a place where you cannot bring, but I don't know. It is just a perception that if you are put in a place where there is no drink, suddenly you think, as if I'm drinking every day. If you are drinking every day, you would not have been in consulting anyway. So these are all perceptions that all the girls are wearing a black dress. Oh, every day you're staring at girls or what? What is that? It's just, these are all, for me, these are all very unnecessary feelings. If you don't drink once in a week, what is the problem? And there are many people who feel that I go to the Middle East, all the girls are covered, I go to get to drink. Actually, all those things can be arranged, by the way, but let us not go. So that is a separate issue. When your clients are princes and the prince son and all of that, everything is available. So, but these are all wrong issues. Yeah? There is no issue. Maybe you cannot drink, but how frequently do you go drink and disco and everything? And anyway, wherever you go, you can fly back to Dubai in 1 hour. Every weekend people come back to Dubai and everything is available openly. In other places it's available, but maybe a bit closed. It's totally different. But that is fact. In openly, you cannot drink. You don't get to see many girls, they have to cover the face, you cannot see that. Yeah. I have the fundamental issue I have faced. I have some colleagues who are philosophically against this idea and they have a difficulty coming to work in such a culture. That is an issue which I can sometimes feel sympathetic, I can relate to. Because it is not that he has to see a girl and he has to drink, it is just that there is a country in the world which doesn't treat men and women the same. And I don't agree with that philosophy of how to treat people, and hence I don't want to work in that country. I had such rare instances. That is something which I start, for me, I can associate with that. You know, it's something that you cannot tolerate as a philosophy in life, and I don't want to work in that country. That such persons, I have told them, okay, fine, don't come. I don't want you to work in that. Because his heart is completely against the philosophy in that country. Not that he doesn't drink whiskey every day and he cannot come. No, you're fired from ADM, by the way. So there is nothing like that. People have a completely wrong impression about the Middle East. The Middle East, if you are a very good team player, you can build trust, if you can build relationships. Middle East is by far the best place. I have done consulting projects very extensively in Europe, in India, in Singapore, in Malaysia, in Philippines, all many, many countries in Europe and the Middle East. Middle East is by far the best place, I feel, that you can do consulting. Yeah, first of all, the discussions happen at the highest level. Most of them are really, really top strategy level projects. You are discussing with the board members, the CEOs and owners who are really worth a lot of money. If you go to other geographies, the CEOs are still employees. In the Middle East, you're already talking to real owners. Okay? When you talk to real owners, your strategic thinking and strategic recommendation is much more pure. What I mean by that is, when you, let us say I'm talking to Singapore Airlines CEO, there's no way I can tell the Singapore Airlines CEO that fire yourself to create value for Singapore Airlines. No way. You see, the strategy is getting compromised. You are looking at the individual's requirement. You are looking at what is good in the short term for that individual. That is not pure strategic thinking. Pure strategic thinking happens when you are talking to an owner. And you can tell the owner that you should fire yourself. This is the right way to handle the company. Forget about short-term financial benefits. Look at creating the value for your children and grandchildren. That is the type of work that happens in the Middle East. It doesn't happen in many other places. And if you believe this, for me this is real, because you are applying your real strategic thinking. It is not corrupted, political. All these components are there in any strategic assignment, but these are all less. It is more pure on how to turn around the company, how to create value for your children and grandchildren and create name for you, things like that. It's much more pure strategic thinking and strategic consulting in the Middle East. And don't underestimate the people in the Middle East. Yeah? They are extremely smart people. They have less experience, may not be exposed to the best quality people, but they very quickly pick up. And over the last 2 to 3 years, I can see tremendous improvement in the quality of the clients. Just they get exposed to this international, intellectual, high-level thinking and framework and concepts and all of that, and they very quickly are picking it up, and they are now almost close to any other developed country the way they are thinking and all of that. Yeah? Do you agree with it? You can debate. I can. It's always good to have an opposing view. I'm almost done. I think I have covered all the questions. I can run through some of the slides. And you have to really work hard, my friend. I've been telling people. See, but today I thought I will not go a bit philosophical, but maybe I should. I'm already started. See, it is hard. how you look at things, at hard working, like how, in consulting versus any other profession, you may meet your family much lesser. No, it is how you look at things. I may have a neighbor who is always with his wife, and I meet my wife once in 2 to 3 weeks, but I think every time we meet, we are honeymoon. She's waiting for me, where is this Thomas? I cannot see him, and so I'll see him, okay, good, good, everything is good, honeymoon. So I have honeymoon continuously. Versus somebody who's like fed up with his wife, I don't know. Seeing them all the time, every day, morning and evening, and night seeing him, getting more. So it's up to you to see, you cannot avoid hard work, right? And you have to have, at least, you should feel the pleasure and happiness of working hard because you are learning. That is the minimum. If you don't have that feeling, in consulting or any professional services career is going to be very tough on you. So you cannot, if you are a person who you feel that your fundamental requirement in life is to quickly earn money and spend it and enjoy it, and you are not seeing that work itself is a pleasure or work itself is something which you are not enjoying, consulting is definitely not suitable, because you will spend 10 to 12 hours average a day on this. And if you're, and your mind has to be clean and nice, huh? It's not like typing and calculating and doing some Excel. Your mind has to be intellectually stimulated all the time. So you have to be generally in a positive mood. You need to be in a happy mood and all of that. So if you put all these things together, if you're working and just for the sake of working and trying to make money, and working 12 hours is putting you in a very awkward situation, unhappy situation. You're worried about your wife calling you and not meeting your wife and family and children. Then your output itself is bad. So it's better to leave consulting and go and do something else. Because you're already doing injustice to the firm, to consulting, to your client, to yourself, to your team members. It's a complete disaster. So you have to have that perspective. And many of the things which I'm talking about consulting may be relevant for many professional services. Wherever you need to work really hard. And I cannot imagine anybody who doesn't work hard progresses very much in their professional career. Because people who come up, you know, at least coming to schools like ISBs and getting good jobs, are already hardworking, are already a group of intelligent people. Huh? So you cannot just survive on your intelligence moving forward. You have to really, really work hard in any good type of work you do. Vacancies, I don't want to say there are, as of now, we have not reached a stage in which the hiring is limited to the vacancies we have. I don't have an instance over the last many years that I have a good candidate who is accepting the terms and conditions, the salary levels which I mentioned, and we like him, not hiring him because there's no vacancy has not happened yet. Yeah? So, you should not be worried about, but there's also some assumptions that is going on. Yeah, I have never been able to go to an institute and find more than 2 to 3 students who clears everything, takes up the offer in ADL, ADL likes them and all of that. So I don't want to say I have 50 of you clear it, will I have vacancies? No, but my assumption is, and based on my experience over the last 10, 11 years, is I have not come across a situation in which we started the process, we like the candidate, we have gone through the process, we've cleared the interview, and then we don't have a vacancy. Because getting good people is by far the toughest thing in consulting. And the Middle East, we are always continuously resource constrained, by the way. We're almost, last year was a bit shaky, but I think it was a very, very unique year. This year, the current running year. But other than that, before that, it was always, always resource constrained. And even now, like it is completely resource constrained in the Middle East office. So it is, you don't have to worry whether we have vacancies. Whoever is able to clear the process, you make an offer, and if you're willing to join, you have the job. What else? I think I have covered, quickly glance through the questions you have asked. I think I have covered all of them. Is there anything that any of you feel that I've asked a question and it has not been covered, yes, go ahead.
Previous requisites to apply, basically most of the consulting companies which come here, it's either dean list and all that. So what are the prerequisites to?
There is no prerequisite. We whoever applies, we will definitely go through the resume, right? And going through a resume doesn't take more than 30 to 40 seconds, I can tell you that. You don't have to assume that I give you 100 resumes. I can go through that in 15, 20 minutes, by the way. It's supposed to be a short resume, we can glance through. Your educational background is important, the grades you have got is important, your work experience is important. Is there any specific criteria that I will say if somebody is not a dean's list, will I cut him off? No. I quickly glance through all of that. Yeah? Maybe he's not in the dean's list, but I look at many other things. So is there a prerequisite by which somebody will not get qualified for R30 little? I don't think so. The fact that you're doing an MBA and ISB, because people with experience, without experience, it doesn't matter. Whether you have industry experience or not industry experience, it doesn't matter. Yeah? Because we just slot you in different places depending on your experience. Yeah? And unless you have 5 to 6 years of experience or even much more than that, your industry experience is not a reason why somebody will hire you. Let us be clear. I have many questions. People say, I have done 2 years, 3 years in something. No, let us be clear. The clients have 20, 25 years of experience. And as a fresh graduate, I worked in Larsen & Toubro for 4 to 5 years. I used to write software. So can I claim myself to be a software expert? Yes, but that is, you just have the work experience. You know how an organization behaves. These are the things you have. That is very good. So you will not make a recommendation, fire 5,000 people tomorrow, because you know it is not possible. Somebody doesn't have work experience may say that. Yeah, but that is not his fault, right? So people having work experience has an advantage, not because of what exactly you did. It is just because how good you were in whatever you did. So if somebody was an extremely good software writer versus somebody who was extremely good in procurement, I'm sure I put him in something else, he'll be equally good. Because when he started writing software, he was not a good software writer, right? When he started putting somebody to do procurement, he was not good in procurement. He became good in that. So if I can become a good software writer and somebody can become a good marketing guy and somebody can become a good procurement guy in the first 2 to 3 years of his career, where he did not have any advantage to start with, he will be surely a good consultant. So let us be clear about these fundamentals. Huh? The experience that somebody has 2 to 3 years, it is important, but not the criteria by which we take you in or out. You have to be good in what you did. That's it. What you did is irrelevant. But if you are a software writer and you are not a good software writer, then it is very unlikely that you will be good in something else. You see where I am coming? Yes.
How much time do consultants spend working in the big tech software review versus their big software, whether it's Dubai or Singapore? Typically,
First of all, it depends on the projects, right? But if I look at the current split, around 50% is in Saudi and other 50 is not in Saudi. So at the office level, I can argue 50-50, but that is not the case with individuals. Because there are some individuals who go on to a case and he likes it and he is there for a year. And there is another individual who go on to a project in Doha for 1 year. You see? So it is 50-50, but one person is 100% in Doha and one person is 100% in Saudi. You see? So trying to get an average for everybody, that is not possible. Yeah. But 50% of the projects are being done in Saudi now, and there is a balancing. I think it will drop a little bit because we are picking up in Doha, in Kuwait, in Bahrain, Dubai, some projects are coming up. So the percentage will slowly move. Yeah. But wherever you spend, you tend to spend longer time. And it may get averaged over 4 to 5 to 6 years. But in the first year, I don't know. You may go to Kuwait for 1 year, you may go to Saudi Arabia for 1 year. We don't know.
Women are allowed in Middle East.
I already have women consultants in Saudi. There was no issue. You will be as a person put under little bit pressure because you have to. You cannot question the culture. That is a given. Yeah. In my personal opinion is, you can keep questioning their fundamental philosophies in life, but who are you to say what is right and wrong? See, in my personal opinion, right or wrong is your own decision, but you cannot decide what is right or wrong for somebody else. Because I have seen so many people in Saudi who feels that culture is very good. Even women. I met many women who say that this is the culture and I believe in it, it has its own advantages, even though I disagree with it, right? But I don't want to say they are wrong. I just want to say I disagree with their thinking and my thinking and their thinking is not aligned. But I don't think we should make a step forward and say that they are wrong and I am right. I think that is a fundamental mistake in my personal opinion. Yeah. And so the moment you are able to accept that cultural philosophies and policies, there are a lot of women working in Saudi Arabia. In the last 2 to 3 years, there are plenty of them. You still have to wear the abaya, you know, but when you come to meetings, you open it up. And you have to be with, but people are very respectful. You see, the fact that what I have seen is like the fact that the person has taken a lot of pain to come and do a project in Saudi Arabia, the people look at it very positively. So I think people have a very wrong perception about things. In reality, it's very different. They are treated with a lot of respect. They are given a lot of space. They command a lot of, you know, they command a lot of respect from the people because, oh, this person has come to my country, is willing to do a consulting assignment where my culture is sort of maybe not supporting the way they're behaving in their country, and she has taken all the pain to come and do a project, and you're treated with a lot of respect. And you have to experience it. I can, if anybody is interested, you go through the interview process, I can put you in touch with many consultants who are in Saudi Arabia, many, many consultants, and they're very comfortable. Some people say, it's so good, you don't know makeup, nothing much. I mean, this is how I don't have to clean makeup, this and that. I just have a fresh and I'm free to do anything in my life, everything is covered. And I don't want to say they want to do it all the time, but they feel that as a difference, you see. Any other questions? Otherwise, I have again gone through the list. I think I have covered all the questions you have asked.
Yeah. Something that is not on the list, but I am interested in knowing that. I was checking USPTO website, and ADL's core competence was in, you know, research-driven consulting. So you have like more than 200 patents. But after 201, there are no patents. So my search is wrong, or something has changed at ADL?
Correct. So see, ADL as a firm, that you can put it as an advantage or you can put it as a disadvantage of ADL, yeah? We have given a lot of importance to things like research and development and patents and all of that, but have not given equal importance of generating commercial benefits from it, you see? That is the weakness of ADL. So we have moved away from doing very fundamental research, creating patents towards, let us maximize the commercial benefits of whatever intellectual property we are developing, and hence the number of fundamental researches and patents have gone down, just to reflect this shift in ADL. Yeah. And it is correct. Because trying to do that, it is not the right strategy to be followed by a commercially oriented strategy consulting firm. It's more like a fundamental R&D institute type of a thing, and that's what ADL used to be, and we were very good in that. We have done some very fundamental researches, and many of the new products in the world has been developed in ADL laboratories. But are we a big company like many other consulting companies? No, because of what I said. Yeah.
So, I mean, has the people changed or has the culture changed?
The people, if people have been able to maintain an R&D and research thinking at the same time, able to think commercially, they have stayed. If not, they have left. And many people have been able to make the shift, and many people have not been able to make the shift. If you're not able to make the shift, you leave. Because, see, in ADL, the partner compensation is variable. So we don't have to ask anybody to leave. The compensation scheme takes care of it. So if I'm not commercially generating a lot of money for ADL, my compensation is very low. So ADL, we just change the compensation scheme. So the right people will continue, and there are few people who still continues with ADL. They are not commercially very successful, but we are also happy with them because they are not drawing a lot of fixed pay. You see, the whole sequence works even now. So there are 2 to 3 people, they are happy with slightly lower pay, they like the ADL culture, ADL is happy to have them, even though they are not commercially very successful, not able to sell large projects, but the cost of ADL is also on the low end because they don't have a variable pay, you see. So we have done very fundamental changes after we went through the Chapter 11 issues in 1999, 2000 and now, and we have implemented
fundamental changes in how we want to run the firm, the process, the type of people, how people are compensated. And the way it is done is in such a way that people will do the corrective actions themselves. We have just put in the changed, updated compensation scheme and all of that. We don't have to ask people to leave, they are not fitting in the philosophy. The processes and the philosophies will auto-correct it.
Can you comment on the economic situation in the Middle East right now, given the crisis, and where do you see it going in the next 2 to 3 years? That essentially will kind of relate to your business growth as well, I mean.
See, in the Middle East, whatever, whichever countries have been relying more on fundamental industries, let us say like Saudi Arabia or Kuwait or countries like that, the impact is significantly lower. Countries like Dubai, which has been more relying on services or real estate or support structures, the impact is much more severe and it will continue to be there. Yeah. Will consulting get impacted? It got impacted temporarily on this year. But in every situation, consultants are still required. So I cannot see any change except the last year. Last year it was very unique, right? But what used to happen before the current year will continue happening in the future years. And consulting market will not have any business will not have any significant impact. Maybe the type of work you have to do may be different. You may have to be much more implementation oriented, much more core results and outputs. Maybe clients may expect much more solid outputs compared to the past. But yeah, and the way countries have got impacted are the countries which have the real core industries versus people who are more on services, and that services sector will get definitely impacted more than the core sectors, and then they will pick up over a period of time. It will take some time. Dubai and all to recover, in my view, will take a few years for sure. It cannot go back to the last year's situation in 2 to 3 years, I don't think so. People may say various things, because in economics, there is a philosophy by which you give positive output, the market reacts, and that itself creates a positiveness in the market. So that is why, in my view, people are projecting a positive picture, because that itself contributes towards positive development. But the fundamentals, there are really some issues which will take many, many years to get corrected. And will it ever come back to what it was 2 years back? I think it will take a very long time. Okay? Thank you very much.